मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडेज टॉपिक इज चेस्ट एक्सरे फाइंडिंग्स इन सीवीएस। एज यू ऑल नो, द कार्डियक चेंबर्स आर द राइट एट्रियम, द राइट वेंट्रिकल, द लेफ्ट एट्रियम एंड द लेफ्ट वेंट्रिकल। व्हाट इज द ओरिएंटेशन ऑफ द कार्डियक चेंबर्स? द राइट एट्रियम लाइज ऑन द राइट साइड, फॉर्मिंग द राइट बॉर्डर ऑफ द हार्ट। द एसवीसी एंटर्स द अपर पोस्टीरियर एस्पेक्ट ऑफ द राइट एट्रियम। द एट्रियल सेप्टम फॉर्म्स द पोस्टीरियर मीडियल वॉल ऑफ द राइट एट्रियम। Now to the left and anterior to the right atrium lies the right ventricle, separated from the atrium by the tricuspid valve. The right ventricle forms the bulk of the front of the heart. The pulmonary valve at the top of the right ventricular infundibulum lies above and in front of the aortic root and on its left side. The curved ventricular septum bulges into the right ventricle. Now you can see the orientation of the right atrium. Here lies the right atrium. You can see it is situated on, forms the right border of the heart, and anterior to the right atrium and on the left side is the right ventricle. You can see it's a triangular shaped structure, and the inter atrioventricular septum, that is the tricuspid valve, it lies at this level. Now coming to the back of the heart, which is formed by the left atrium. The left atrial appendage projects forward and to the left from its upper left border. The pulmonary veins enter the posterior left atrium. The left atrium is flattened from front to back. So this is the left atrium, which is situated here on the back side, that is anterior to the spine. And this is the left atrial appendage, which projects onto the left side. Now the left atrium and the ventricle, as you know, they are separated by the mitral valve. The left ventricle, which forms the bulk of the left heart border, it lies in front of the left atrium. The atrial and ventricular septae lie in approximately the same LAO plane, forming the septal plane of the heart, separating the right heart chambers anteriorly and on the right from the left heart chambers posteriorly and on the left. So you can see that the atrial and the ventricular septae, they lie in the left anterior oblique position. They are separating the right sided chambers anteriorly and on the right from left sided chambers posteriorly and on the left side. Now the mitral and the tricuspid valves lie in approximately same RAO plane, right anterior oblique plane, forming the AV plane of the heart, separating the ventricular mass in front and on the left from the atrial part behind and on the right. So this is the atrioventricular septae, walls, which will divide the atrial chambers on the back and on the left from on the right from the ventricular chambers on the right and in the front. Again, this is to show that the interatrial and the interventricular septae, they are in cross or perpendicular to the mitral valve and the tricuspid valves, and both of them lie obliquely. Now coming to the individual heart chambers. Right atrium, it has a smooth globular body and a triangular trabecular appendage pointing upwards, forwards and to the left, separated by crista terminalis. The superior and the inferior vena cavae enter the posterior wall of the right atrium some way from its center. The right atrial appendage is the only part which projects in the lateral view. So you can see that this is the right atrium as seen on a chest x-ray. You can see it forms the predominantly the right border of the heart. Left ventricle forms the left border of the heart. Right ventricle is situated, it's a triangular shaped structure situated in front on the anterior most aspect. This is the pulmonary artery arising from the right ventricle, and the SVC and the IVC, they drain in the right atrium just beyond its center. This is the aorta arising from the left ventricle. This is the left atrium or the left atrial appendage which will project on the left side. Now this is a selective right atrial angiogram. You can see how the right atrium is situated in the thoracic cavity. On the frontal view, you can see this is the right atrium, this is the tricuspid valve, and this is the right ventricle, which is situated more anteriorly. And on the lateral view, you can see that the only the right atrial appendage is projected on the lateral view, and it is seen to overlap the infundibulum and the pulmonary valve. Now coming to the right ventricle, as I have already told you, from the front, it is the bulk, it forms the bulk of the front of the heart. From the front, it appears as a triangle with the base on the diaphragm. At the top is the pulmonary wall leading to pulmonary artery, I showed you. And on the left and anteriorly is the apex of the right ventricle. In the lateral view, the right ventricle is flattened from behind by the ventricular septum. No contribution is given by the right ventricle on the frontal film. Only on the lateral view, right ventricle forms the front of the heart with the lower half normally in contact with the back of the sternum. You can see this is again a selective right ventricular angiogram. On the frontal view, it's seen the triangular shape of the left ventricle is seen. Beyond the pulmonary wall is the NPA, which forms the floor of the pulmonary bay on the chest X-ray. This is where the pulmonary bay will be seen on a chest X-ray. On a lateral view, you can see that the right ventricle is forming the anterior most aspect of the heart and giving rise to the pulmonary artery. You can also see that left atrium is situated most posteriorly. Now coming to the left atrium, it receives the four pulmonary veins at the corners of its posterior surfaces and empties through the mitral valve in its lower anterior aspect. Left atrial appendage is a long finger-like forward projecting structure which is buried in the epicardial fat pad and so it doesn't produce a discrete shadow. Left atrium does not contribute anything on the frontal fin. However, on the lateral view, it forms the upper posterior border of the heart. Superior and posterior borders of the left atrium may be located by the left lower lobe bronchus. You can see that the left lower lobe bronchus will pass obliquely downwards and to the left, above and behind the left atrium. So the boundaries of the left bronchus will tell you where the left atrium is situated. You can see the pulmonary veins entering into the left atrium. And again on the lateral view, you can see the right ventricle is forming the predominantly the anterior aspect of the heart. It is in close relation with the sternum. This is the left ventricle forming somewhat the posterior border. However, the upper posterior border is formed by the left atrium. Again, you can see on an axial view, you can see this is the left atrium receiving the pulmonary veins. This is the right atrium, the right ventricle situated anteriorly. Coming to the left atrium, the angiogram of the left atrium, it shows the shape of the left atrium. This is how the LA looks like and this is where the left atrial appendage is seen. No part of LA forms the cardiac sillout in frontal view, as I've already told you. However, in lateral view, it forms the upper posterior cardiac border. Now, the left ventricle. It's again a cone-shaped structure with a long axis pointing downwards, forwards and to the left. The apex of the left ventricle forms the cardiac apex. So, what is how the apex of the heart is formed? It is formed by the left ventricle apex. And most of the left border in the frontal view is formed by the left ventricle. On the lateral view, the left ventricle forms the posterior cardiac border below the mitral valve, as I showed you, continuing to form the inferior surface in contact with the diaphragm. This is the left ventricle, which is forming the lowermost part of the lower posterior border of the heart, just below the mitral valve, and continuing to rest on the diaphragm. This again shows right ventricle, left atrium, pulmonary artery, and the aorta. So, on the CT images, you can easily delineate these findings. This is left ventricular angiogram on the frontal view. It shows the shape of the left ventricle. Apex is forming the apex of the heart. Position of the aortic valve is shown. Okay. So, from here, aorta will arise. On lateral view, left ventricle forms the inferior border of the heart. And LA is located posteriorly. This is the mitral valve. Left atrium, mitral valve, left ventricle, and on the frontal view, left ventricle, aortic valve, and the aorta. This is a case of VSG seen on an oblique scan. You can see there is a defect in the interventricular septum. Coming to the cardiac sillout, cardiac shape in hypostenics, it is long and narrow, while in hyperstenics, it is transverse. In moderately built people, it will be oblique or globular. In adults, 2/3 of the heart lies on the left side. So, predominantly it is noted on the left side and 1/3 will be noted on the right side of midline. In infants, heart is of transverse or globular shape. And in infants, right heart is almost equal to the left heart. In infants and young children, there is enough thymic tissue to obscure the base of the heart and great vessels. By the age of 5 to 7 years, the globular infant heart attains the adult size. Cardiac contour. On the PA view, right heart border has two segments. The upper is almost vertical. It is formed by the SVC to the right of the ascending aorta. While in the lower border, it is convex, which formed by the lateral border of the right atrium. Sometimes IVC may be seen as a triangular shadow in the right cardiophrenic angle rising through the diaphragm to enter the posterior aspect of the right atrium. You can see this is the IVC coming up through the diaphragm and entering the posterior part of the right atrium. Again on the lateral view you can see. So this is the cardiophrenic angle. Left heart border, it has distinct segments. First of all, we'll see the right heart border. You can see the right heart border is formed by the superior vena cava and the right atrium. Left heart border, in the uppermost part, it is rounded and convex, formed by posterior part of transverse aortic arch known as aortic knuckle or knob. So, left heart border starts from this, from aortic arch. Then, immediately below this, a flat or concave border, which is formed by the trunk of the pulmonary artery. It is known as pulmonary conus or bay. So, this is the pulmonary conus or bay. Prominence of conus is a normal variation in young females and children. Now, below this is a small concavity, which is formed by the left atrial appendage. Between pulmonary bay and the left atrial appendage is the left bronchus. So, you can differentiate the upper boundary of the left atrial appendage. The lowest and the largest segment of the left heart border is formed by the left ventricle. Diaphragmatic or inferior border is represented by the right ventricle, I have told you earlier, and apex is formed by the apex of the left ventricle. So, the left heart border is formed by aortic arch, pulmonary bay, left atrial appendage and the left ventricle. Now, on the lateral view, the anterior border, it's formed above by the right atrial appendage, I showed you earlier, and below it is formed by the right ventricle. Posterior border above by left ventricle, left atrium and below by left ventricle. The normal left atrium may be recognized confidently when the left bronchus is visualized because it marks the upper and posterior part of the left atrium. In some patients, IVC may be seen to enter the posterior wall of the right atrium, I showed you on the lateral fin, and its posterior border of the IVC marks the posterior border of the right atrium. So, posterior part of the IVC marks the posterior border of the right atrium. Now, coming to the cardiac size. Cardiothoracic ratio, it's the ratio between the transverse cardiac diameter and the widest internal diameter of the thorax in PM. In neonates, it's 60%. So, the heart will appear larger as compared to adults. Infants, 55% and adults, 50%. Heart enlarges in two hemodynamic situations. Either it's a diastolic volume overload, leading to severe pulmonary plethora or valvular regurgitation and pump failure due to inherent pump weakness, cardiomyopathy or mechanical like coarctation or AS or PS. Now, how do you measure cardiac size? First of all, you in the midline, that is above the spinous processes, overlying the spinous processes, you draw a vertical line, a straight vertical line. The frontal film should be centralized. It's a prerequisite. So, when you draw this vertical line, from this vertical line towards the right side, the maximum dimension is measured by a ruler. Again, on the left side, the maximum dimension is measured by a ruler. Now, you add both of these, right plus left. And then you divide this by the transverse diameter, which is the maximum measurement of the thorax from inside of the ribs. So, R plus L divided by transverse diameter will give you the ratio. So, it is, as I have already told you, 60%, 55% and 50%. More than this, that means there is cardiomyopathy. Assessment of chamber enlargement. Right atrial enlargement, it's less commonly enlarged. It's less common and harder to delineate on the chest radiograph than the left atrial enlargement. Causes of right atrial enlargement can result from a number of conditions including raised right ventricular pressures, pulmonary arterial hypertension, CORPI, valvular diseases like TR, TS and Epstein's, ASD, atrial fibrillation, dilated cardiomyopathy. On a frontal view, the right atrium is visible because of its interface with the right middle lobe. So, there is a delineation. Subtle and moderate right atrial enlargement is not accurately determined on plain fins because there is normally no visibility, because there is normal variability in the shape of the right atrium. Now, features of right atrial enlargement are non-specific, but they include enlarged globular heart, narrow vascular pedicle, gross enlargement of the right atrial shadow, that is increased convexity in the lower half of the right cardiac border. Right atrial convexity is more than 50% of the cardiovascular height, and right atrial margin is more than 5.5 cm from the midline. So these are two objective criterion, otherwise you visualize. So you can see that the right atrium is enlarged, it is projecting much beyond the para midline. You can measure it from the midline. In a case of TS, right atrial enlargement is seen. The right heart border bulges to the right and shows increased curvature. In lateral view, increased application of the heart shadow to sternum. Why? Because of large right atrial appendage, which is filling in the gap superior. Again, a case of right atrial enlargement. Now, left atrial enlargement may result from many conditions, either congenital or acquired. It has some characteristic findings on chest X-ray. Acquired causes, mitral stenosis, MR, LVF, LAM, atrial fibrillation, congenital like VSD or PDA. Now, on the plain radiograph, as the left atrium enlarges, it will become directly visible or it will displace the adjacent structure, so you can come to know that the left atrium is enlarged. Now, how do you directly visualize the enlarged atrium? Because of a double density sign. When the right side of the left atrium pushes into the adjacent lung and becomes visible superimposed or even beyond the normal height border, it is known as atrial escape. So, this is the double density sign where the right heart border is projecting much beyond the right heart border, known as atrial escape. Oblique measurement of greater than 7 cm. How do you measure it? It's measured from the midpoint of the left main bronchus to the right border of the left atrium. This obviously a double density will be seen in this. And this is the most reliable sign on chest radiography. Convex left atrial appendage, known as third Mughal sign. It normally, the left heart border just below the pulmonary outflow tract should be flat or slightly concave. If it is projecting outside, that means the left atrial appendage is enlarged. That means the left atrium is enlarged. Now, what are the indirect signs? Splaying of the carina with the increase of the tracheal bifurcation angle to over 90 degrees. Posterior displacement of the left mainstem bronchus on the lateral radiograph. As we know that the left mainstem bronchus forms the posterior and superior border of the left atrium. So, if it is pushed back, that means left atrium is enlarged. Right and left bronchi, therefore, they will not overlap, but they will form an inverted V sign, sometimes referred to as the walking man sign. Now, superior displacement of the left mainstem bronchus on the frontal view and posterior displacement of the barium-filled esophagus or nasogastric tube. So, this is uplifting of the left main bronchus leading to the increase in the angle of the tracheal bifurcation. Again, you can see that there is a discrete shadow. It should ideally be flattened. However, there is a convexity which is because of enlargement of the left atrial appendage. Coming to left ventricular enlargement, it enlarges. It's situated on the left side. It enlarges to the left and posteriorly, and slightly to the right and anteriorly. So, what will we see? Rounding of the apex of the heart, which is formed by the left ventricle. It may be the only sign, and is often seen before overall cardiac enlargement has developed. It may be due to muscular hypertrophy and can be recognized before significant cavity dilatation has occurred. Elongation of the long axis of the left ventricle. It's again the earliest sign of left ventricular dilatation. Plain X-ray will show axis of heart is extending to the left and downwards to a variable degree. The cardiac apex may extend below the diaphragm, where it may be difficult to recognize. So, rounding of the apex of the heart and elongation of the long axis of the heart. Now, bulging of the heart shadow behind esophagus on lateral view. Less reliably, in the exact true lateral view, posterior part of the left heart border formed by the left ventricle, it will bulge behind the entry of the IVC into the heart shadow, and occasionally it may be the only sign with normal heart shadow on frontal view. You know the causes of the left ventricular enlargement. So, what can be seen? Left ventricular dilatation will lead to left heart border display leftward, inferiorly, posteriorly. Left ventricular hypertrophy, rounding of the cardiac apex. And Hoffman-Rigler sign. On a lateral chest radiograph, if the distance between the left ventricular border and the posterior border of the IVC exceeds 1.8 cm, this is measured at a level 2 cm above the intersection of diaphragm and IVC. Then if it is extending beyond this IVC, so that means left ventricle is enlarged. You can see this is a bulky triangular heart on PA with enlarged main pulmonary artery and the lung vessels. In lateral view, whole of the heart is in contact with the sternum. Though sternum is also bored, but still there is a large amount of contact. You can see this is the left ventricular border situated here. However, the IVC border is here. So there is an increased distance. That means there is left ventricular hypertrophy. Smooth sign, it's appearance of a prominent rounded left ventricle and dilated aorta on a plain AP chest radiograph, giving the appearance of Smoo, which is a fictional cartoon character. You can see dilated left ventricle and the dilated aorta. Now, right ventricular enlargement, it's also known as right ventricular dilatation. It can be a result of all these causes. Now, on a plain radiograph, frontal view will demonstrate rounded left heart border again, uplifted cardiac apex. Lateral view will show filling of the retrosternal space because right ventricle is situated anteriorly and rotation of the heart posteriorly. So, for right ventricle, as you know, it doesn't form any boundaries on the frontal fin, so it's better appreciated on the lateral view, where you can see that cardiac silhouette is occupying more than 40% of the lower retrosternal space. This is reasonable sensitivity but poor specificity. Now again, an angiogram of the right ventricle, which shows that the left heart border is now being formed by the right ventricle. On the lateral view, you can see that maximum part of heart is in contact with the sternum, while the left heart is pushed posteriorly and lifted off the diaphragm. You can see it because the right ventricle is pushing it. Again, a case of right ventricular hypertrophy, you can see rounding of the entire left heart border, which is made of enormously dilated right ventricle, which was seen on angiography. Now, right ventricular hypertrophy in a patient with TOF, with elevation of the cardiac apex. Again, you can see this leads to the elevation of the cardiac apex. AST on a plain X-ray, it can be normal in the early stages when the AST is small, or there may be signs of increased pulmonary flow, enlarged pulmonary vessels, upper zone vascular prominence, vessels visible to the periphery of the film, eventual signs of pulmonary arterial hypertension. And it can also lead to chamber enlargement. ASD will lead to right atrial, right ventricular enlargement. And you should know that left atrium is normal in size, unlike VSD or PDA. And aortic arch is small to normal. So this is a case of ASD, which shows an enlarged heart with prominent vascularity noted in both the lung fields. The aortic arch is normal or small, and the left atrium does not appear enlarged. You can see the normal angle of the tracheal bifurcation is maintained. VSD, again, chest radiograph can be normal with a small VSD. Larger VSDs may show cardiomegaly, particularly left atrial enlargement, although the right and left ventricle can also be enlarged. A large VSD may also show features of pulmonary arterial hypertension, pulmonary edema, pleural effusion, and increased pulmonary vascular markings. This demonstrates prominent pulmonary vasculature noted bilaterally, which is active congestion. However, there is no pleural effusion or no consolidation, and the heart appears prominent. PDA, the chest radiographs will differ whether it is isolated or associated with other cardiac anomalies and with the direction of the shunt flow, whether it is right to left or left to right. It can have cardiomegaly, predominantly left atrial and left ventricular enlargement, obscuration of the aortopulmonary window, and features of pulmonary edema. Coming to the cardiac shapes, a boot-shaped heart noted in TOF, elevated rounded cardiac apex, right-sided aortic arch, and a narrow vascular pedicle. This is a classical case of TOF. Again, sitting duck sign in PTA, elevated rounded cardiac apex, high right aortic arch, and concave pulmonary bay. This is again a classical chest X-ray for a PTA. box shaped square heart, which is noted in Epstein's anomaly, with a prominent right atrium, atrialized portion of the right ventricle, and sharp cardiac outline because of poor pulsations of the heart. This is how an Epstein's anomaly looks like. Figure of 8, or snowman or cottage loaf of bread heart, noted in the supracardiac TAPVD cases. You can see this is a snowman sign in TAPVR. Horizontal egg-shaped or apple on a string-shaped heart, it is noted in uncorrected TGA. There is a narrow vascular pedicle on the frontal view. So this is a horizontal egg-shaped heart on a frontal view. Corrected TGA, here you will see gently convex upper left cardiac border, ascending aorta of L-loop configuration, and a wide vascular pedicle on the frontal view. This is corrected TGA. Normal pulmonary vasculature. The left border of MPA forms the floor of the pulmonary segment. Normal pulmonary segment is concave or straight. Enlargement of MPA will cause a convexity of the pulmonary arterial segment. Now the MPA, that is the main pulmonary artery, bifurcates within the mediastinum into right pulmonary artery and the left pulmonary artery. Intrapulmonary branches parallel the bronchi. They divide in an orderly fashion and gradually taper towards the periphery. The arteries and bronchial branches are approximately of the same diameter at any particular level. This is important while diagnosing the pathologies. The left pulmonary artery and the left hilum are 1 cm above the right pulmonary artery. Why? Because the left pulmonary artery arches over the left main bronchus, thus, and the shadow of the left hilum is predominantly formed by the arteries. So it's the left hilum is higher than the right hilum. The veins are wider, less well-defined, and branch less often than the companion arteries. These are located medial to the companion artery in the upper zone, overlap the companion artery in the middle zone, and lateral to the artery in the lower zone. Pulmonary veins converge into the LA. I showed you 2 to 3 cm below the hilum. Pulmonary arteries radiate from the hilum above the pulmonary venous confluence. Normally, pulmonary arteries and veins in the outer one-third of the lung are too small to be seen in chest X-ray. So, if you visualize them, that there is something abnormal. You can see the bifurcation of the pulmonary artery, left pulmonary artery and the right pulmonary artery. Left pulmonary artery giving rise to left upper lobe segmental branches, left interlobular artery and the left lower lobe segmental branches. This is the right pulmonary artery. You can see the left pulmonary artery is higher. Right pulmonary artery leading to right upper lobe segmental branches, again the right interlobar artery and the right middle lobe segmental branches and right lower lobe segmental branches. Pulmonary hilum. The lung hilum or roots are found on the medial aspect of each lung. In the left hilum, the left pulmonary artery occupies the upper part. Below it is the left main bronchus. There are two pulmonary veins. One lies in front and other lies below the left main bronchus. Right hilum, bronchus of the upper lobe and branch of the right pulmonary artery to the upper lobe originate prior to entering the hilum. Thus, the upper lobe bronchus and artery are found above the level of the right main bronchus and the right pulmonary artery. The structures of the lung hilum, they are encased in a sleeve of pleura, continuous below with the pulmonary ligament. In addition to the structures above, there are bronchial vessels, autonomic nerves, lymph nodes and lymphatic channels. Pulmonary vasculature. Radiologically normal pulmonary vascularity in CST when there is no heart failure, no large shunt, no extreme pulmonary stenosis. Then there may be increased pulmonary perfusion or plethora, enlarged pulmonary arteries and veins in all zones, recruitment of capillaries into active pulmonary circulation in outer thirds and upper zones, which is not normally seen. So plethora correlates with the size of left to right shunt better than the heart size. So if there is plethora, shunt is more than 2:1. No plethora, shunt is less than 2:1 in 100% of cases. Radiological signs of plethora, presence of shunt vessels, end-on vessels, more than 2 times the diameter of the accompanying bronchus, prominent upper and lower zone vessels, end-face vessels below the level of 10th posterior rib on frontal view, prominent vessels below the crest of the diaphragm, right descending pulmonary artery more than that of the trachea, the measurement, more than 6 vessels in peripheral, one-third of the lungs, prominent hilar vessels on the lateral view. In infants and children, generalized mottling may be seen. So you can see it, just visually you can see that there is pulmonary plethora, very large heart central as well as peripheral pulmonary vessels, prominent upper lobe vessels are also seen. Again, a case of pulmonary plethora, dilated pulmonary artery, dilated pulmonary artery segment, increased caliber of the right descending pulmonary artery and prominent end of vessels, they are located in both the lungs. Decreased pulmonary perfusion or oligemia. Normally, the healthy neonate lungs may appear underperfused because they are still in intrauterine high resistance state. Isolated right heart obstruction needs to be severe or associated with proximal right to left shunt to show as oligemia on chest X-ray. How will you know oligemia? Concave or absent MPA, overall appearance of an over-penetrated film. Because the heart will be small, you will feel vasculature will be less, so you will see more blackness on the films. Less than four vessels in periphery, one third of the lungs, smaller hilar lobar segmental vessels. Decreased size and density of hilar vessels on lateral chest X-ray in presence of cyanosis suggests pulmonary oligemia. So this is a case of pulmonary oligemia. You can see it appears as if there is an over-penetrative film because the blackness of the lungs is very prominent because of absence of or decreased vasculature. Again, a case of pulmonary oligemia caused by pulmonary atresia. There is diminutive hilar and segmental pulmonary arteries, concave main pulmonary arterial segment, right aortic arch, and again there is also scoliosis. Pulmonary venous congestion and edema may result due to failure of the left heart to clear blood delivered to it due to pump failure or obstruction. On chest X-ray, both alveolar and interstitial edema will be seen. Now, the pattern of visible edematous interlobular septal lines is different in infant and small child. The central A line predominant, that is crisscross reticular linear pattern, rather than the regular costophrenic parallel horizontal curly B line seen in the adult. So, these are the curly A lines which are predominantly seen in the infants and children. By the curly B lines, the peripheral horizontal lines are more visualized in the adults. And thickened edematous pleural fissures are well seen on the lateral chest X-ray. These are cases of pulmonary interstitial edema. In grade 1 mild PVS, you can see cephalization of the blood flow with increased caliber of the upper lobe vessels. Interstitial edema, second stage, will lead to curly B lines. This is the grade 2 PVH. You can see the curly B lines. And there are also curly C lines. These are short lines which do not reach the pleura and do not course radially away from the hilar. So these are curly A lines, B lines and C lines. The third stage is alveolar edema. Here, the interstitial fluid is accumulating at rates faster than it can be removed by lymphatics. So, this will lead to a bat wing appearance. You can see it appears like these are the wings of a bat. So, this is a grade 3 PVH with diffuse alveolar edema. Next is pulmonary arterial hypertension, which occurs when the main pulmonary artery pressure is more than 20 mmHg. It may be mild, moderate, severe, 20 to 29, 30 to 39 and more than 50. The central vessels from the MPA to the second order branching vessels will be seen to dilate, and peripheral or the lobar vessels will constrict. The transition between the centrally dilated and the peripherally constricted vessels will be more lateral. So there will be more dilated central vessels in cases of left to right shunts. What is pruning of the pulmonary vessels? It is more than a 50% loss of the vessel diameter at any degree branching and is suggestive of pulmonary arterial hypertension. Chronic pulmonary arterial hypertension leads to calcification of the main pulmonary artery and proximal branches. The presence of calcification is pathognomic of pulmonary arterial hypertension. So you can see primary pulmonary hypertension, this massive enlargement of the pulmonary trunk and the right and left main pulmonary arteries. Aorta. Ascending part, it doesn't form any part in cardiac sill out on PA view. Most posterior part of arch of aorta will form the aortic knob or knuckle. Infants and young children, it's not well seen. Position is just inferred by extrinsic impression of knuckle on the lateral margin of the air-filled trachea. Descending aorta, straight line passing downwards, and it is towards the midline of the left of the spine. So So you should look whether the aortic knuckle is right or left sided. Aorta is enlarged. If so, then any disproportionate enlargement of ascending aorta or arch of aorta or descending aorta. Look for calcifications in the aorta, their location, pattern and extent. Pericardial effusions, these occur when excess fluid collects in the pericardial space. Normally, pericardial sac contains 30 to 50 ml of fluid. However, more than 200 ml of pericardial fluid will be seen on a chest X-ray. Radiographic signs include water bottle configuration. There is a globular enlargement of the cardiac shadow. On a lateral chest X-ray, you will see a vertical opaque line which is formed by the pericardial fluid. It will differentiate a vertical lucent line directly behind the sternum, which is the pericardial fat. It will be lucent. Then there will be a vertical opaque line because of pericardial fluid. And behind this posteriorly, there will be similar lucent vertical line because of epicardial. So, pericardial fat, pericardial fluid and epicardial fat. So, this is known as Oreo cookie sign. Widening of the subcarinal angle without other evidence of left atrial enlargement. So, that means this is due to pericardial fluid. You can see leather bottle appearance because of water bottle configuration because of the globular heart because of pericardial effusion. You can see this opacity. Now, the skeletal features, most important skeletal feature is rib notching of lower margin of 3rd to 8th ribs due to large tortuous intercostal arteries supplying descending aorta in coarctation. Premature fusion of sternal centers of ossifications, absence, bowing, depression, deformity are all seen in CHT, especially in the septal defects. You can see that there is a depressed sternum. This is giving rise to a false impression of ASD. Why? Because there is a left heart shadow displaced to the left side, a large heart shadow displaced to the left side, straightening of the left heart border with prominent pulmonary corners, vessels to the right are prominent. Now, this is because of depressed sternum. How will you... what is the clue to the real etiology? It's the spine seen through the heart shadow. Normally, the lower part of the spine is not visualized in a frontal chest X-ray. And there is increased slope of the anterior ends of ribs. And on a lateral view, it showed the sternal depression. Scoliosis frequently accompanies CHT. Severe genetic and metabolic disorders are also associated with skeletal changes. Trisomic chromosome 21, Down syndrome, Turner's, Noonan syndrome, all these are associated with varied presentations of the heart diseases. Holteren syndrome, Ellis-Van-Creveld syndrome. Thalidomide toxicity again produces phocomelic changes and may be associated with cardiac malformation, congenital cardiomyopathy in MPS and GST. Cardiac abnormalities are more frequently associated with upper limb than lower limb. Why? As both the arms and heart, they undergo major development during the fourth week of intrauterine life, whereas the lower limbs develop appreciably later. Post-surgical stigmata like surgically deformed ribs, unilateral rib notching, surgical sutures, valve and conduit prosthesis should be carefully looked for on plain X-ray. So, skeletal features, skeletal deformities can also give a clue to some associated heart disease. Visceral situs, the normal position of the viscera, heart and stomach on the left, liver on the right. This is known as situs solitus. Congenital heart disease is much more frequent if abdominal viscera are in reverse coronal position, that is situs inversus, or in indeterminate position, that is situs ambiguous. Best guide to abdominal situs is position of gastric air bubble. In situs ambiguous, the lower margin of liver is often abnormally horizontal. Intrathoracic visceral situs closely corresponds to atrial situs. The morphological right atrium being almost on the same side as the right short bronchus and the trilobe lung. So, right atrium and the right lung will be seen on the same side. Situs solitus, left stomach and left-sided left atrium usually also have left cardiac apex and left aortic arch, bilobe left lung, trilobe right lung. Situs inversus with mirror image dextrocardia, there is left to right reversal of the cardiac chambers coupled with the right-sided stomach, right apex and right arch. There is ventricular inversion, left ventricle, that is the smooth one, is located on the right side, and atrial inversion, right atrium is located on the left and vice versa. Patients with cartilaginous syndrome have situs inversus with mirror image dextrocardia. Now, situs indeterminatus or situs ambiguous or heterotaxia, there is abnormal arrangement of the organs and vessels. The stomach and liver are typically midline, and congenital heart disease occurs in 50 to 100% of such cases. Major subcategories of situs ambiguous include asplenia and polysplenia. So this is a case of dextrocardia. This is the right marker. So whenever you find that on a frontal chest X-ray, the heart is situated on the right side, that is on the side of the right marker or opposite to the left marker, that means you have to confirm whether there is a problem in the marker or there is dextrocardia. Otherwise, you can see the liver is on the right side, the stomach bubble is on the left side. So abdominal situs is normal while there is just dextrocardia. So thank you for giving your kind attention.